themselves. Courage and moral force were not always enough. Though equipped with the modern Lee Metford rifles and supported by excellent artillery and Maxim machine guns, the army suffered a lack of maps. Now, this combined with a severe shortage of cavalry often left British commanders with extreme communications difficulties. Though a great victory was won at Modder River in November 1899, the pursuit was not followed up. Consequently, the Boers were permitted to withdraw in relatively good order, and so prepared defensive positions for the next confrontation at Magersfontein. The Boers had the luxury of time to construct a network of trenches sufficient to repel Medved's eventual attack with heavy casualties. In contrast to the British, only 250 Boers fell in the battle. The Boer general, Christian de Wet, was present in these early stages of the war.
On the morning of the 9th of December, I received a telegram from States President Stein, asking me to go to the Western Frontier as Wächt General. During the time I had spent in travelling, three important engagements had taken place, namely those of Colernso, Magersfontein, and Stormberg. At Colernso, the English had suffered heavy losses, and 10 guns had fallen into our hands. Magersfontein also had cost them dear, and there General Vaukoper had met his fate. While at Stormberg, 700 of them had been taken prisoner, and 3 of their big guns had been captured by us. In the meantime, the enemy were shelling our positions unceasingly. Not a day passed but 2 of their lyddite guns dropped shells amongst us. Mishaps.
Hardly had the force at Magersfontein been repulsed when news broke of a reverse in another sector. The British defeat at Stormberg had exacted an even higher price in lives. For the relief of Ladysmith were the largest field contingents yet deployed by British commanders. The 16,000 infantry and 5,000 cavalry were placed under Sir Redvers Buller, a veteran of Zulu War and several other colonial African conflicts. Buller seemed to the English press the archetypal hard-bitten veteran, and it was felt by many that if he could not turn the tide, then no one could. But a succession of minor defeats government into taking action. Buller was replaced. The task of retrieving the British Empire's desperate situation in South Africa fell upon the shoulders of the celebrated General Bobs Roberts. The eyes of the Victorian world were upon him. Meanwhile, in the veldt, Buller was still officer commanding British forces, and his next major engagement was fought at Spion Kop. The battle raged for 4 days, from the 19th to the 24th of January in the new year of 1900. Though responsibility lay with Buller, the affair was badly mishandled at a tactical level by the local commander, General Sir Charles Weaver. Again, despite gallantry under fire by British troops, the Boers achieved another victory. The battle is perhaps a grim foreshadow of the tangled horror of trench warfare, which would engulf the world little more than a decade later. With the arrival in South Africa of Roberts, the situation began a definite improvement. By May 1900, the sieges of Kimberley, Mafeking, and Ladysmith were lifted, much to the relief of the British public, as Sir Arthur Conan Doyle remembered. Even sober, unemotional London found its soul for once fluttered with joy. Men, women, and children, rich and poor, joined in the universal delight. Such was the euphoria as Boer forces were systematically driven from the invaded territories. The Boer field forces were now incapable of defeating the better supplied and commanded British army in pitched battles. And Roberts had now banished the spectre of Black Week from the minds of nervous British soldiers. but the Boers refused to accept defeat. The capture of the Boers' towns, the conventional signifier of victory, was ignored by them. Like the Russian armies in 1812, leaving behind their burning Moscow and withdrawing into the Russian interior, the Boers changed tactics and strong forces to a war of guerrilla tactics, tying down vast numbers of imperial troops for a further 2 years. But Roberts had succeeded. Before the year was out, he was recalled to London to be rewarded as Commander-in-Chief of the British Army. He was replaced in the field by Kitchener. Following the success of Roberts' offensive campaigns, Kitchener was left with a vast mopping-up operation. Kitchener was an adept national in its difficulties. The veldt still contained an operational enemy composed of the surviving commandos. These units could still rove the vast hinterland because they could gain assistance from the Boer farmsteads. Seeing quickly this source of field supply, Kitchener resolved to strike at the heart of the problem, reasoning that the Boers were unbeatable otherwise. He devised a plan that was nothing if not characteristic of his qualified approach to war.
The next principle, now along all the railway lines, and there were a few, not many, but there were some railway lines through the republics, they put a post, first of all, every mile, which was called a captain's blockhouse, which had a captain and perhaps 20 soldiers to command it. Once they'd done those, they had what was known as a subaltern's blockhouse every half mile, the halfway point, and eventually they even had the NCO's blockhouse, which was a corporal and perhaps three men, in the gaps every quarter of a mile between the captains or the subalterns' blockhouses. All of them linked, of course, by that modern invention, the railway telegraph. So they had the ability to pass messages. Now, eventually 4,000 of these posts are set up all over the veldt, because Kitchener had the first real operations room, bigger than this room here. It had a great sand table, or rather a map table, with an absolutely accurate depiction of all the towns, all the railways, and every single post with its numbered veldt, because the Royal Engineers had a signal capacity by now, so they began to link them by telephone line. They were not supposed to, and if some post did not report in, that meant there'd probably been attacks, so immediately an armoured train would be sent up the line to investigate what was going on, and so forth. Coming into a central intelligence centre and headquarters, he was really doing rather like the Battle of Britain, the girls with the tin hats pushing little symbols over the map. They were putting symbols on for a Boer commando, estimated 4,000 strong with cattle, moved southwest between points 401 and 402 last night. That was the next thing. So he got a very good intelligence network going, supplemented, I should mention, by several very famous majors, Royal Engineers, who again were his key intelligence on-the-spot information finding.
Thus enclosed, Boer families were no longer able to aid their kinsmen, who were always on the move. With this coldly efficient system came another yet more sinister creation. Boer civilians were removed from their farms and housed. These would later come to be known as concentration camps.
The British authorities decided the only thing to do was to concentrate the Boer population from the veldt. And to do this, they set up a name which has gone down into infamy, concentration camps. 40 of these concentration camps were established, and they had two types of populations in them, which were not, however, necessarily divided. First of all, there were the families of the hands uppers, those are the Boers who wished to surrender to the British power and become a British colony. They'd had to be evacuated from the veldt because, naturally enough, the Boer bitter enders, those who were going to fight to the end, were not pleased with their colleagues who were willing to become collaborators and were killing them. So we brought into these concentration camps the hands upper families and added to them then more and more of the bitter ender families, which did nothing for the morale of the camps. And they weren't like Lancash, they were not divided into Republican area and loyalist area and so forth.